Puneet sir, who is head of department, and Professor Rahul Sana sir, who is my guide. Our today's case is pertaining to a 29-year-old gentleman who is laborer by profession, a married and Hindu, a resident of Ghazipur, Uttar Pradesh, who presented to our OPD with complaints of swelling in the left thigh for 2 years and episodic pain in the swelling for last 4 months. History of present illness. The patient was apparently asymptomatic 2 years back when he noticed a swelling of about 2 cm in size over anterior part of the left upper thigh, which was insidious in onset, gradually progressive and associated with recent rapid progression in the last 6 months to the present size of approximately 30 cm. It was not associated with restriction in motion during any time of the evolution. The swelling was also associated with pain for the last 4 months, which was insidious in onset, gradually progressive, episodic pain and dull aching, mild in intensity with no migration or radiation associated, and there were no aggravating factors, and it was relieved on oral medication. There's no history of any skin ulceration, discharge, weakness, tingling or numbness in the lower limb, or any swelling of the whole limb. There's no history of fever, or there's no history of any trauma associated in the past. There's no history of any swelling elsewhere in the body. There's no history of any loss of appetite or weight loss. There's no history of difficulty in breathing or cough, hemoptysis, headache, seizures, visual disturbances, vomiting, abdominal pain or distension, jaundice or irritable bowel habit. There is no history of any bony pain. Past history. This history of an excision of a similar swelling, which was approximately 20 cm in size, over the same site 8 years ago. This it is undocumented as, and there is no document available regarding the diagnosis and the further workup which was performed. There is also a history of an electrical burn over the left thigh at 3 years of age, which didn't require any immediate treatment, and patient did not receive any follow-up treatment also, and it was not associated with any limb deformity over the period his age. And there's no known comorbidity like diabetes, hypertension, tuberculosis, asthma, or any other thing. And there's no history of any radiation exposure or chemical exposure. Family or social history. The patient is married for the last 10 years and has 2 children. Last child is of 3 years of age. And there's no history of any cancer or cancer-related death in the family. The patient is of upper or lower class according to Kuppuswamy scale. Personal history. The patient has a mixed diet with a good appetite, and his sleeping pattern is normal and is not disturbed by the pain in the swelling. The bowel and bladder habits are regular, and there is no history of any substance abuse. Treatment history. The patient took oral medication for the pain in over the swelling since the last 4 months, and there is history of excision of left thigh swelling 8 years ago, which was, as I told you, undocumented, and which was followed by an asymptomatic period of 8 years. And there is no history of any other hospitalization or drug allergy. Summary. This is a case of a 29-year-old.
Just wait. Yes, really, this is Professor Dr. Sachin Jamma. Sorry, I joined a little late. Good evening, everybody. Professor Sangwal and all my friends. See, in history, you have mentioned two things. One is electrical burn, yes, and some injury to the same limb. And number two, history of previous surgery. So how is it important in relation with this case?
Sir, history of a previous allergy could determine a recurrence which could have occurred of like a malignant disease, or it can be a completely de novo episode. And a history of an burn or such a trauma over the site could be a precursor for any new plastic changes which can occur in the future. Or it can be also a artifact, sir. It can also be an artifact finding, sir.
Is the patient complaining of any ulcer over there?
Yes, sir. There is an ulcer. Healed ulcer over there.
So healed ulcer. Okay, fine. Yes. So if there was an ulcer, was it important to know?
Yes, sir. The ulcer which occurred at 3 years of age, it was not associated with any change over the course of time, and there is no change in any characteristics of the ulcer which has occurred.
Fine.
Over the
fine.
Time.
Is it important anyway?
Yes,
this
sir.
Case?
Yes, sir. Sir, history of change in ulcer could determine the malignant conversion of ulcer, which could lead to sarcoma or carcinoma, sir. Carcinomatous changes, sir.
Which malignancy is commonly seen?
Marjolin ulcer, we are trying to rule out here.
Fine, please continue.
Yes, sir. Summary. This is a case of a 29-year-old gentleman with swelling over the anterior aspect of left thigh for the last 2 years and episodic pain for 4 months with a rapid progression in the last 6 months. It is associated with no functional impairment of the limb and no constitution symptoms and a history of excision of a similar swelling in the past.
Can you on history come to some conclusion? Fine, of course, we'll go to the detailed diagnosis later on, but some conclusion.
Sir, given the size of the swelling and history of a rapid progression over a shorter period of time, and also a history of a similar lesion in the past, the swelling is not of inflammatory, or we can turn our focus over a neoplastic kind of swelling rather than a benign swelling like inflammatory. Or accident, post-traumatic swelling.
May I ask you? Look, just go back to your summary.
Yes, sir.
Is this electric burn associated in the same area where there is this tumor?
Yes, sir.
So that would be important to mention that in your summary. Why have we just done away with that? Also, was the lump excised, was in the same area where he has the lump now?
Yes, sir.
So both of them, you have to mention that the lump now is in the same area which was excised. And
sir,
this
I
was the same. No, in your summary. So that,
yes, sir.
Look, the summary means what all the facts which are going to tell you exactly what you're aiming at. Your
yes,
diagnosis,
sir.
Okay? So yes, that electric burn is also associated with the same thing. So is the tumor which was excised before.
Yes, sir.
Right? So I think
upon general facial examination, after taking informed consent, the patient was examined in a well-lit room with adequate exposure in the presence of a chaperone. The patient was conscious, cooperative, and well-oriented to time, place, and person. The BMI was 20.76 kilogram per meter square, which was within normal limit. The Karnofsky performance status of the patient was 90. Hydration status was adequate. There was no pallor, icterus, swelling, cyanosis, generalized lymphadenopathy, or pedal edema. The vitals were pulse was 86 per beats per minute in right radial artery. It was regular, normal, volumic, and character, with no radio radial or radio femoral delay. BP was 122/74 millimeters of mercury in left arm in supine position. Respiratory rate was 14 breaths per minute and temperature was afebrile. Upon local regional examination, after proper informed consent, the patient was exposed from the waist down with adequate privacy maintaining and examined comfortably in standing and supine position. Upon inspection, there is a single swelling situated in the left anterior proximal two-thirds thigh region of about size 32x20x12 cm, extending from 5 cm inferior to anterior iliac spine, inferiorly extending up to 10 cm above tibial tuberosity, and it involves approximately 60% of the thigh circumference. These are the various pictures of the same swelling. We can see a scar mark of the previous incision which was taken, and also the
Hold a minute. Go through quickly so that YouTube doesn't get blocked. Okay. Go through quickly as genitals are seen.
Yes, sir. Surface appears smooth with a few nodularity over it, and margin were diffuse and ill-defined. The skin over the swelling is dense and shiny, with visible engorged veins and a 24-centimeter linear scar mark extending 6 cm inframedial to anterior tubular iliac spine towards the medial part of the lower border of swelling. There is a 5x4 cm post-burn scar seen over the lateral aspect of the swelling. The movements of the limbs are not restricted above the hip or the knee joint, and there is no edema of the limb or deformity at the joint. There is no distal muscle wasting, and no visible pulsation is seen over the swelling. Upon palpation, there is no local rise of temperature, and there is no tenderness. The inspective findings are confirmed. The margin are ill-defined and the consistency was firm. The swelling is not fixed to skin and it's non-compressible or reducible. There's limited mobility from side to side perpendicular to the muscle axis. And the swelling became less prominent and immobile upon along the axis of the muscle upon torting the muscle. And the swelling was not fixed to the underlying bone. Also, there was a finding of a 1.5 cross 2 centimeter palpable lymph node in the left inguinal region, which was hard in consistency and immobile. Upon auscultation, no bruise was heard over the swelling, and the right thigh was normal on examination. Upon neurovascular examination.
Have you finished with the picture? Have you finished with the picture?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay.
So maybe sir, I can ask you some questions over here?
Yes, sir.
Or are there any pictures ahead?
No, sir. These are the pictures, sir.
Okay. Okay. So one thing you mentioned is skin is not fixed to the tumor.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. How did you check that?
So we try to pinch the skin and lift the skin up. And if the pinchability is present, then the skin is not fixed to, the swelling is not fixed to the skin.
Yeah, I can see two scars on the swelling.
Yes, sir. One.
So are these scars not fixed to the underlying swelling?
No, sir.
Are you sure?
Sir, the ulcerative scar is not fixed to the swelling, as well as yes, sir. Both scars are not fixed to the swelling.
Okay, fine. Second, you said there is a mobility of the lump,
yes, sir,
along the perpendicular to the direction of muscle fiber. So how have you checked for that?
Sir, along the axis of sir, we are here suspecting the anterior compartment of the thigh muscle involvement, and perpendicular to their axis, we tried to move the swelling and it was mobile over it. Not freely mobile, but there was mobility present perpendicular to the axis of the muscle, sir.
And but upon torting, we always test the mobility in two directions. So how about the other direction?
Yeah, sir, along the axis of the muscle, upon torting the muscle, the swelling was not mobile.
One more thing, Dr. Avivarar, you need to check when you contract the muscle.
Yes,
one is mobility, another is becoming more prominent or less prominent?
Yes, sir, it became less prominent. As I mentioned, so, sir, it became less prominent and immobile when the muscle was made taut.
How did you exactly contract the muscle?
We are suspecting quadratus femoris muscles involved, mainly the anterior compartment thigh involves that. So by giving a resistance against the motion of the quadratus femoris, we made a short.
How exactly?
The patient was placed in a supine position, and the patient was given instruction to extend his knee against our resistance, and upon doing so, his muscles were made taut, and immobility and prominence of the swelling was checked.
Fine. Okay. Next, please.
Yes, sir. Upon neurovascular examination, sir, there were no fasciculation or twitching and tremors. There was no visible wasting of muscles distal to the swelling. There was normal movement at the hip and the knee joint. The power was 5 by 5 in the left lower limb. There was no normal sensory and motor examination, and deep tendon reflexes were intact. In vessel examination, femoral pulsation were not accessible at the pathological site, that is our left side. But the popliteal, anterior and posterior tibial pulsation were palpable on the left side and comparable to the pulsation to the right side.
Okay.
Upon systemic examination, the cardiovascular system examination was normal. Respiratory system examination suggestive of bilateral air anti-equal with normal vascular breath sound. Abdomen examination was within normal limit, and CNS examination was also within normal limit, sir.
Continue with your summary. After that, I will ask you one question. Yeah, continue with your summary.
Now, as we summarize, this is a case of a 29-year-old gentleman with swelling of the anterior aspect of left thigh for 2 years and episodic pain for 4 months. Rapid progression in the last 6 months associated with no functional impairment of limb and no constitutional symptoms, with history of accession of similar swelling in the past and a history of electrical burn over the left thigh at 3 years of age. Upon examination, there is single swelling of size 32x20x12 cm situated in the left anterior proximal 2/3 thigh region with a diffuse margin and firm persistency and immobility over trotting the muscles with no neurovascular deficit and palpable inguinal lymph node and no restriction in the joint movement.
Yeah, Aviral, before you go to diagnosis, we have gone a little fast in the family history. Why did you, what is the importance of family history in cases like this?
So, family history, such tumors are, they have a germline mutation also, like various syndromic associations. Yes.
Just be clear, specifically one or two examples you give. Don't go on telling germs and mutation and all. Just give one example.
Neurofibromatosis.
That's what I wanted.
Leaf from any syndrome.
So that's what is expected. So keeping that in mind, do you think in general physical examination you should have mentioned something else, which probably examiners will give more marks?
Sir, keeping consideration in general examination, we should also inspect a head-to-toe examination for any other swelling or any lesion like cephalic spot or.
Very important. So that is an important thing. I want you people to understand that that is the importance of head to toe. Sometimes you may get a clue that, oh, he has got a cephalic spot. So it may be a negative point, but it has got importance. You will get more. Yes, history of trauma, did you ask?
Yes, sir. There was no history of any trauma associated.
Whenever a patient undergoes one surgical procedure, for example, in this patient, he has undergone a surgical procedure. You need to probably take more detail what happened to that swelling, whether it was completely removed, whether the patient told you that it was still there a little bit, or what was the final pathology report. He may not tell you, but what has been done, whether he was advised radiotherapy, all the details you should be able to get from the patient.
Sir, I was inquiring about it, but the patient had no... much knowledge about it, and the excision was not documented. What was the diagnosis and what was the workup was not documented, sir.
We know now what is the diagnosis, but that doesn't matter. I just want you to understand whenever you get it like this. And so now one or two questions from my side at this juncture. Can you name some benign tumors which can recur? See my question. Benign tumors which are known to recur. Can you tell me first?
Sir, lipoma can recur.
How can lipoma? One minute, just hold on. How can lipoma recur if you remove it properly? It won't recur. It may start in some other place which you are not. That is different. Lipoma won't recur. Tell me. Think. Yes. One or two examples. This is how we ask you questions. Okay. You heard of desmoid tumors?
Desmoid tumors.
You heard of fibromatosis? You heard of keloid? Keloid is not a swelling. Don't try to excise it. And also, pleomorphic adenoma is notorious for the friends. You heard of phyllodes? Phyllodes?
Yes, sir.
Few examples you should know. This is one of the malignant tumors. Obviously, it has recurred. That's a different issue. But so these are the few questions from my side. Sir, please take over.
Sir, I have one question. Can you call it a recurrent tumor in your summarization and all that? There is clear history of excision at the same site.
What is it? Rumba?
So in your summarization and diagnosis, you can put it as a recurrent tumor.
Sir, the patient was asymptomatic for 8 years. Sir. And there was, according to the patient, there was no lesion remaining after the previous excision, and these all changes are completely de novo. So, sir, I don't think it goes in the direction of recurrence.
In view of the long duration,
yes, sir.
You are thinking it's not a recurrence.
Yes.
So, if that is the situation, Aviral, what may be that swelling which was excised?
Sir, it can be a similar lesion also. It can be a giant lipoma. Because the characters of the swelling was quite similar to our presenting complaints, sir. So it could have been a similar carcinoma or similar neoplasm in the past, or it could have been a benign swelling like a large lipoma could have occurred. they were, sir, the last swelling was not associated with any fever or any constitutional symptoms. So we can easily rule out abscess.
Any counter medicine advice, please?
Abscess or hemangioma, sir. Like, there is no issue of any vascularity or traumatic abscess.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, sir. The prevention diagnosis is soft tissue sarcoma of the left anterior thigh.
Do you want to consider any differential diagnosis?
Sir, considering such a large swelling, which has progressed over a shorter period of time, sir, I would go with this vision working diagnosis. But we can also consider any hematoma or any abscess formation, which can. But sir, it's not a conclusive. Only this diagnosis can be taken as a working diagnosis, sir. Given
would you
the
like to
point
give,
in the history.
Give a differential diagnosis of hematoma or abscess for here?
No, sir. It's quite a large swelling, which has.
Yes,
yes, sir. I won't like to give.
Okay, and can you clinically, of course, we will go to the staging later on, but can you clinically stage the disease over here?
Sir,
there are some important findings in your examination.
Yes, sir.
It will help you to stage the disease.
Sir, the dimension of the disease are indicating towards the TCO lesion, and also there is a lymph node present, which is suggestive of regional metastasis, so N1. So, sir, it can be T4,
usually,
N1.
Yeah, it is usually rare, actually, getting a lymph node metastasis. But if it is there, it directly puts it into stage 4.
Yes, sir.
Fine. How will you proceed now?
Sir, now we would like to confirm our diagnosis first. We will investigate to confirm our diagnosis. Then we will investigate to know the extent of the disease and likely metastasis or not. And then we will proceed with the additional investigation to help in planning our further line of management. So, sir, initially, sir, we would like to do imaging. Like, sir, first we have to do high frequency ultrasound with color Doppler, sir, and we can also go for, we can have to go for MRI of thigh involving the hip and the knee joint. And sir, beyond that, and in the same setting also, we can do imaging guided four needle biopsy also.
Okay, so one is ultrasound, second is MRI, and third is image guided biopsy.
Yes, these diagnosis, these are required to reach a diagnosis. Then we will plan further investigation to look for metastasis or any extent of the disease. Like CCD chest is required, such a large swelling, which can be indicative of sarcoma, requires CCD chest. Even CCD abdomen and pelvis can be required, sir. And depending upon the tissue diagnosis, even MRI spine or NCCT brain can be required, sir.
Okay, now because you mentioned the word biopsy, there's so many things we can discuss about biopsy.
Yes,
tell me something, like naturally you are a resident, so it is quite possible that somebody may ask you to do biopsy of this case. So how will you proceed? If I ask you to do a biopsy of this patient, how will you proceed?
Sir, I would like to proceed with image guided core needle biopsy under setting of ultrasound or the MRI CCT. And sir, because this such sarcomatous swelling have a variegated appearance, and we want to take the biopsy from solid areas, and we want to avoid the necrotic or the cystic area. So we can delineate them better in image guided settings.
Agreed. Next.
And sir, if the core needle biopsy demonstrates less tissue or is of non-diagnostic value, then we have to go for incisional biopsy, sir.
What precautions will you take if you go for incisional biopsy? What rules
sir.
You should follow, or what precautions will you take?
We should possibly take the shortest trajectory possible, and from the most prominent part of the swelling, and the incision should be vertical, given vertical, and flap should not be raised. Any hemostasis should be secured, and no hematoma formation should be allowed. and drain placement should not occur. If any drain placement does occur, the drain should be taken out from the initial incision site only. It should not be taken out away from the swelling. And sir, the trajectory path we are taking should be planned in such a way that it is finally included in our excision which we are planning later on.
Yes, correct. Absolutely right. So important is you should not detect any other tissue plane apart from the area where you are going to take the biopsy.
Yes, sir. We should also avoid. We should also avoid incorporating more than one compartment, and also avoid damage to any neurovascular bundle also.
Correct. What other investigations now?
And now, sir, USG, sir, high frequency USG with color Doppler, sir, to look for the extent of the swelling, the plane involved, and possible tissue of origin, and as well as vascularity. Or any vascular compression is occurring due to swelling or not. And we could also go for MRI of thigh, incorporating the one joint above and one joint below, so that we can look about the plane of the swelling and tissue segment possibly involved, as well as the neurovascular bundle involved.
Okay. Next.
And sir, in the metastatic workup, we have to go for CCT chest to or HRCT chest to look for any pulmonary metastasis. And some cases like myxoid round cell liposarcoma or angiosarcoma and even leiomyosarcoma, CCT abdomen and pelvis becomes necessary to rule out any intra-abdominal metastasis. Also.
What else?
We want to do MRI for all the cases? Or you have some protocol indications?
Sir, if the swelling is large in size and the history and is indicative of a sarcoma, it is greater than 5 cm in size, then we have to go for MRI, sir. And sir, if it is less than 3 cm size, we can easily and not fix to the skin or the underlying musculature, we can easily go for excisional biopsy without any further radiological workup. And we can send for excision, excisional biopsy.
So what else you want to do? What other metastatic workup you want to do?
Sir, if indicative of MRI spine can also be undertaken, or even MRI brain can be taken for some specific types of soft tissue sarcoma like alveolar cell sarcoma and clear cell sarcoma.
So what will you do with the lymph node? You mentioned that, sir, there is a lymph node.
Yes, sir. Sir, we will try to go with lymph sparing functions preserving the wide local excision.
No. For the lymph node.
The lymph node excision.
You mentioned about one lymph node, no?
Yes, sir. We will go with the lymph node excision and send for biopsy.
You want to do it before you plan the proper surgery?
No, sir. During surgery.
Why did you tell lymph node excision? Why not the ultrasound guide definitely? When you have already got a soft tissue sarcoma, such a large one. Anyway, you are doing a core needle biopsy for the sarcoma, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Clinically, definitely you said heart doesn't matter in spite of that. Which is easier? As far as the secondaries are concerned, you can do ultrasound guide FNAC because you already got a primary by the TrueCut, no?
Yes, correct? Sir. Yes, yeah. Sir.
Now, what are the types of liposarcomas, you know?
Yes, sir. Three types of liposarcoma have been defined. So, first is well-differentiated and de-differentiated liposarcoma. Second is myxoid or round cell liposarcoma, and third is pleomorphic liposarcoma.
So accordingly, if I tell you that 8 years back this was a sarcoma, now tell me which sarcoma can be, if at all. You are telling it is benign swelling. I still think it could be malignancy only, but doesn't matter. What it can be, which type of sarcoma? What I'm trying to tell is, any types of, you have just now told three types of liposarcoma.
Yes, there's
one variant, which you said, is known for a recurrence. You know, it doesn't spread.
Mixoid round cell, yes. Liposarcoma.
Yes. Mixoid sarcomas are known for a recurrence. It is they are known to have a good prognosis in spite of recurrence. That is the one possibility you need to keep it in mind if you are suspecting a liposarcoma in this patient. Okay.
Yes.
But now you just told about that soft tissue sarcoma left anterior thigh, right?
Yes.
So now just tell me what are the any other types of sarcoma you are giving a diagnosis in this now, or you just want to keep only liposarcoma?
Sir, most common sarcoma in such setting is liposarcoma.
Yes.
But we can also go with leiomyosarcoma, sir, and alveolar type of rhabdomyosarcoma.
Leiomyosarcoma.
Sir, leiomyosarcoma doesn't occur. It occurs mainly retroperitoneal, but it can occur.
Why did you tell that rhabdomyosarcoma? How old is your patient?
29-year-old. It occurs in children.
So don't try to unnecessarily get into trouble. Yes, liposarcoma. Any other things? Fibrous tissues there in the thigh. What other malignancy?
Dermatofibrosarcoma.
No. I meant
fibrosarcoma.
Fibrosarcoma is old terminology. It is not. What other things?
Undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma.
Okay, anything else? So MFH means.
Yes, undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma, which was previously known as MFH, malignant fibrous sarcoma.
You would like to know, that's what the examiners will try to ask, because they want to know roughly you have read only liposarcoma and come, or they would like to have a broader idea.
Yes,
so what are that's why they will ask you all these perfect questions, like a neurofibroma, also neurolemoma, all that thing you should know whenever you get a case like this. You said angiosarcoma. What are the sites of angiosarcoma? You know, any idea?
Sir, angiosarcoma most commonly occurs in the trunk area, followed by the head and neck, trunk area, followed by head and neck area, and followed by extremities, sir.
So, and liver, liver, breast, of course, head and neck. Yes, so, basically, they can occur anywhere, but wanted to understand the common things are definitely liposarcoma. You have to give a diagnosis. Yes. And then when the question is asked, what are the types, then only you come out with the other possibilities, right? Sir, please take over.
Yes. Now you have come to, you have got a biopsy. You have done, examined the patient, done the investigation. So tell us something about TNM classification of sarcoma.
So the TNM classification based on the latest AGCP classification, the T component has four parts. TX is an
American joint committee.
Yes, sir. The T component has four classification. The TX is not diagnostic. T1 is less than or equal to 5 cm swelling. T2 is more than 5 but less than or equal to 10 cm swelling. T3 is more than 10 but less than or equal to 15 cm swelling. And T4 is more than 15 cm swelling. N has two classification, N0 and N1. N0 is no regional metastasis, and N1 is regional metastasis present. And M has M0 and M1, distant metastasis present or not. So according to that, M0 and M1 is there. And sir, grading is there. And sir,
grading.
Yes, sir. The grading is based on tumor differentiation and rate of mitosis and area of necrosis. So based on tumor differentiation, we have a score for 1, 2, 3 scores. The first 1, 2, 3 delineation. The first demonstrate that first denotes that our sarcoma is identical to the adult mesenchymal tissue. The second denotes that our sarcoma has a clear defined histology, sir, and that the type 3 denotes that it is undefined or embryonal or Ewing's sarcoma or synovial cell sarcoma or soft tissue osteosarcoma or a doubtful classification is there. upon rate of mitosis, sir, the first point denotes that there is 0 to 9 rate of mitosis per 10 high power seed. The second denotes 10 to 19 per rate of mitosis rate per 10 high power seed, and the third denotes more than 20, sir. And in necrosis, lymph node necrosis, the one point denotes that there is no necrosis. The second point denotes that there is less than 50% necrosis, and third one denotes more than 50% necrosis. According to that, by combining the scores of the each of the parts, we reach a grade, sir. Grade one is still 1 to 3. Grade two is 4 to 5 scores, and grade three is more than 6 scores.
Now, which in this classification, how do you fit your patient?
Sir, in this classification, sir, we need to go for tissue biopsy, but after tissue biopsy and all, it was defined that it is a grade 2 carcinoma. Sir.
Why grade 2?
Sir, because sir, due to it was sir, the, for, in the area of differentiation, sir, it was a well-defined liposarcoma came out, which was given up a score of 2. And sir, the area of the rate of mitosis was quite low, sir, and the score was given 1, and there was no significant necrosis was seen upon the biopsy, sir. So total score of 4 was given, and a grade 2 was given.
Okay, and TNM wise, how do you fit it?
TNM wise, sir, T4N1M0.
T4N1?
M0.
Yes, sir. So now, how do you proceed with the treatment?
Sir, we would like to, such as large swelling, sir, but if first we will investigate the type of, what is the tissue biopsy. Depending on that, we can plan for preoperative radio or chemotherapy. And after that, we will go with limb sparing function preserving wide excision of the swelling with a margin of 1 to 2 centimeter preferably. And after that, depending on the tissue diagnosis and other grade and all, we can plan for post op radiotherapy and chemotherapy.
Okay. What new adjuvant therapy you're planning for?
Sir, if this tissue is a well-defined liposarcoma, a well-defined liposarcoma is generally radio and chemo resistant, so we can only go for excision. But any myxoid variant and all is radio sensitive, and given such a large size, we can go with pre-op radiotherapy. Then we can proceed with our wide excision.
Is there any disadvantage of pre-op radiotherapy?
The disadvantage, sir. Sir, no, sir, I don't know, sir.
Actually, what happens is, because of radiotherapy, there will be a lot of tissue fibrosis and arthritis. So, post-operative healing will be a problem. But of course, you have to weigh the situation.
Yes.
Depending on the size and the grade of the tumor. Now, the second question is, how about chemotherapy?
Sir, going with liposarcoma diagnosis, well-defined liposarcoma or chemo-resistant also, we cannot go with chemotherapy in these
cases. Fine, here is no histopathology, but otherwise.
Yes, sir. Otherwise, sir, we can go with, if it is a high-grade tumor of a large size, like T2 or more than T2, sir, we can plan for chemotherapy. Like some tumor, like even sarcoma, as well as myxoid liposarcoma and synovial sarcoma. These are greatly chemosensitive. So in high grade large tumor of mainly these variant, we can go with chemotherapy. New adjuvant chemotherapy can be doxorubicin and isocosamide or vincristine. Like such regimes like VAC regime and doxorubicin.
What are the common regimes? Yeah, what are the common regimes used?
Sir, initially we can go with doxorubicin, or if it is not incorporated, we can go with isophosphamide, or common regimes are a VAC regime and a MAID regime.
MAID regime, yes.
Yes.
Even AIM regime also is used, I think.
Yes, sir.
Now, see, this patient, you have, I think, probably you have a histopathology, so you must be having MRI findings also.
Yes,
we are not aware. So, if possible, yes. Can you tell us those MRI findings so that we can think or discuss the treatment also?
Sir, I have MRI finding documented. I don't have that. Okay, sir.
Yeah.
And it was a large heterogeneous tumor with a solid and a fatty component in the mainly incorporating
can
the
you move that slide so that we can see the MRI finding.
Yes, sir. It was a large heterogeneous mass, approximately 30x19x10 cm, with mainly fatty and solid component involving the muscle of the anterior compartment. And post contrast enhancement was there. Neurovasculature was intact with no infiltration. It was suggestive of query liposarcoma.
Okay, so here it is mentioned that this neurovasculature is intact. Does it make any difference?
Yes, sir. There is abutting or encasement of our margin of tumor is quite near to our neurovasculature, we need to remove the adventitia or perineurium, sir. And if there is major encasement of neurovasculature, we can plan for amputation also, sir. Conserve our neurovasculature.
No. Can you not replace the vessels and nerve? Is it now not possible to do it?
Sorry, it is possible, but if a large component is involved, like in such a large swelling of this type, we can plan for amputation if we cannot replace the vessel and nerve.
Now, one important question. I'm not aware about the onco work being done in your institute, but suppose if you are at an institute which is a small one, a small medical college, maybe at periphery. So, will your department do this case? What do you suggest? If you are a chief surgeon, what will you do?
Sir, considering the benefit of the patient, it's always better to refer the patient to a higher center which is much more specialized in such type of cases.
High volume center. You will have to refer this patient to a high-volume center, considering giving the best possible treatment to the patient.
Yes, sir.
You should not do such cases at periphery or small setups. That is most important for you. Okay?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Now, regarding reconstruction part, have you thought over it? See, as far as possible, we avoid amputation in such patients.
Yes, sir.
So, there is a large scarred area. So that you will have to excise.
Yes, sir.
So how do you cover it?
Sir, we have to cover it with flap. Like we cannot use graft and all. We have to raise the flap and we have to cover it with it. And there's no...
Maybe you'll have to plan for radiotherapy later.
Yes.
It has to be covered with flap. Plus, you want to give a good cosmesis, good function. That is equally important. So, any flap you have thought of?
We can go with latissimus dorsi flap in this region. We can incorporate it.
Latissimus dorsi, I doubt. Fine. You, of course, need help of your reconstructive surgeon, no doubt.
Yes, sir. Sir, I don't know. Sir.
So, in case now, see, what has happened is your diagnosis is stage 4 disease.
Yes, sir.
Okay, what is the prognosis in such patients? If the lymph node is positive, proved histopathologically, what is the prognosis in such patients?
Sir, the 5-year survival rate is around 40-45% in this patient, sir. And there's a very
Are you sure?
Yes, sir.
For my knowledge, it is just 10-20%.
Okay, sir.
So again, you'll have to weigh the situation. Can we go for a very morbid surgery? We'll have to think about it again. We'll have to evaluate further and decide whether we should go for a definitive surgery in this patient or not. Fine. What is the prognosis in stage 1, 2, and 3 then?
In stage 1,
prognosis in 5 years survival. What I mean is 5 years survival.
Sir, So in stage 1, approx 90% 5-year survival rate is there. In stage 2, approx 70% 5-year survival rate is there. And in stage 3, approx 30 to 40% survival.
Do you expect lymph nodes here with diagnosis as liposarcoma?
Yes,
do you think the lymph node will be positive?
Liposarcoma can spread through lymphatic metastasis, so it can be possible.
What are the common sarcomas that
spread through lymph nodes? Undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma, sir. Liposarcoma, sir. And clear cell sarcoma, angiosarcoma, epithelioid sarcoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, and sir, synovial sarcoma.
Okay, but I think it is less with the liposarcoma. What do you say, Chennai, sir?
Yeah, relatively less, sir. But what you yes, said, this is a case of where recurrence and skin is also involved. Burn scar was there, and this another planes are opened up here. So because of the previous surgery also, one is a burn, so there is a possibility, sir, on that.
Rare chance.
I have one or small thing, sir. That is the, when MRI has given you so nice report of neurovascular intact, I think you should not say amputation.
Sir, we want for, sir, we are not planning for amputation. Sir, in case neurovascular is major neurovascular structures are involved, then we have to go. In this case, sir, we will go limb sparing, sir, function preserving surgery. Wide excision we will do with a proper margin.
Yes, sir.
Please mute now.
Sir, I was saying that in this case neurovascular is intact. But in case this major encasement of a neurovascular structure, then we have to go for, we can plan for amputation. In this case, we will plan for limb sparing and function preserving wide excision of the swelling.
Because however large the tumor, Very many times they do not infiltrate the. You only said popliteal artery is nicely palpable, no? You only
yes,
said.
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh, and what is the other nerve you are worried in the thigh here? Tell me. Which nerve you are worried? You said neurovascular bundle. Vascular, yes, we can understand. Adductor magnus, that area, you have a superficial femoral artery going there. Yes. What is the other thing you are worried?
Sir, in this area, sir, femoral canal is planned, femoral nerve can be
injected. So where is your swelling? Where is this big lesion?
In the anterior part of the...
According to me, it seems to be away from that area. Does the patient have any radiating pain to the knee joint?
No, sir.
Why I asked that question?
Sir, because femoral nerve involvement can radiate to hip and the knee joint, sir. The pain can lead to hip and knee joint.
You know any hernias which can give rise to this kind of one important sign there?
Obturator hernia, sir.
What is that sign called as? Good.
Hauschild-Bromberg sign.
Hauschild-Bromberg. So these are some of the clinical clues for you. So you only said pain is dull, aching and local. So no radiation to the knee joint at all pain. And a neurovascular bundle is intact. So try to hold on to the amputation till the examiner ask you last, you know, that what is your worry in excising this, that you need to answer. What is your worry? Means what are the muscles which you need to sacrifice? That is the answer we want now. Tell me.
Sir, in such a large swelling, which is mainly towards the anteromedial side, sir, we have to excise for anterior compartment muscles like the quadratus, the rectus femoris and the vastus muscles, as well as we can, if the extending towards the medial side and involving the medial compartment too, then we have to excise the adductor muscles too.
So that is why MRI, what is the report of MRI? Can you see
MRI
that?
Was suggestive
anterior
of
compartment. So yes, medial compartment is not involved,
it's na? Not involved, yes, sir.
So what is the disability cost if you remove this anterior compartment muscles? Let us see.
Sir, yes, sir. So anterior compartment muscles, sir, sartorius and the quadratus femoris. So the functions of the both muscles will be lost. Sartorius is responsible for the abduction and flexion at the hip joint, and abduction and extended rotation at hip joint and flexion knee. And so mainly the quadratus femoris is responsible for extension at the knee joint. So extension at knee joint.
Can you tell me any other muscle which can extend the knee other than the quadratus femoris which you are talking about? So do you think a patient will be not able to walk if you remove that quadratus? Even the gluteus maximus, you know, gluteus maximus, the tensor fascia lata, extension of the knee, and helps in the, you know, walking. There will be disability, no doubt, but you know,
but
that has to be accepted rather than doing amputation. So you should not tell that, you know, especially a case like this when it is comes like this. Yes, and so one problem what you should tell is disability. Second is, are you sure that when you exercise it will be a R0 resection? So what do you mean by R0 resection?
Sir, R0 is a pathological diagnosis. The pathologist reports that there was no margin, like no positive margin is there, or 1 mm at a distance of approximately 1 mm.
So what your answer should be, the main other thing is that, you know, worry is just R0, especially such a large one. So that is the time you need to consider post-operative radiotherapy. Okay, yes, so this was question was asked, you know, that preoperatively it is usually it is difficult, so not sensitive. So, yes, so best you should try to say that I will try to exercise, but there are some limitations. You need to look at disability. Suppose you need to sacrifice the nerve and artery, means then limb may go for gangrene or whatever. Then there's a different issue. A case like that. So, sir, please take over, sir. These are a few questions from my side.
Yeah, I think we have just 5 minutes. So, there are many professors attending this clinic. So, are there any other questions from other dignitaries over here?
Can I ask one other question?
Yeah, please.
Aviral? Am I audible?
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
What is compartmental? Compartmental excision?
The compartmental excision involves the complete excision of the muscle groups involved in the sarcoma from their origin till insertion.
So, in this patient, can we go for a compartmental excision or not?
Sir, as it is not involving the complete complete thigh, which from the origin till the insertion, like the knee joint is spared and all the anterior compartment muscles are insertion occurs at the knee joint, and sir, there's not is a possibility of leaving a good margin, sir. We should avoid compartment resection, sir. We can plan for a wide excision with a margin of.
Because already this patient has got a recurrence. Patient has got a recurrence. You go for a wide local excision, and as I said, you may not achieve R0 resection.
Yes, sir.
So, sir, shall we, Sridhar sir, shall we close this case now? Because we'll have to go for the next case.
Dr. Ishwar Osman, do you have any question, sir? He's a principal and professor of surgery in KIMS. Sir, unmute, sir. Sir, unmute. This is a soft tissue sarcoma thigh.
Yes, sir.
So, you have any questions, sir, please?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir. Good evening. Sir, I joined late. The precautions for the biopsy has taken. Have you asked about that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that has been discussed.
No. Okay, sir. No, sir. Go to the next case. No.
Okay.
Most of the things are covered.
Sir, well done. Dr. Sridhar has done well. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
And can we go to the next case now?
Thank you, teacher.
Yes, sir.
Can I say something?
Yeah, sure.
You know, this is our unit case, Jay.
Yes.
So I did not ask any questions. But you know, it was a very
you can give the expert opinion, sir, always.
Yeah. You know, this was a very interesting case because this patient had a past history of excision of the almost about 20 centimeter mass, which was there in the same region. And for 8 years, he was completely all right. Then there was history of the electric burn in that area also.
Yeah.
So when this boy showed me today morning, I said, if this electric burn is there, why it is not related to the electric burn? Because it is not only the marginis ulcer will develop over a post-burn thing which is there. You can have a sarcoma also arising from that. Mm-hmm. So why it is not that? But he rightly said that, sir, it is not, it is free. That, and I did see that. That electric burn scar which was there, it was free from that tumor which was there. And then I asked second question about that, why the 8 years difference is there? He was not having anything, but there are known cases of sarcomas which has been described in the literature that they remain. So it's not that it was a lipoma at that time, as Dr. Shenoy said that it was a case of some type of a sarcoma even at that time, but it remained dormant for such a long period. And then it has come in a very short period and become almost about 30 centimeter lump. So all these were the interesting parts which was there in this patient. And, you know, this is a patient of the oncology unit, our surgical oncology unit.
Yeah.
And this boy told me that they are deciding about carrying out the amputation.
Oh, said,
no, no, no. It will be not. No, you will not utter this word in this forum. About the amputation. Correct. When everything fails, then only you will come to the amputation. Please do not say, utter the word of the amputation.
Yes.
Okay, that's absolutely. It, yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Let us go for the second case, please.